اللهم صل على محمد وعلى
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن العالمين.
اللهم صل على محمد.
خدمت شما خواهران و برادرهای عزیز، من میگم اولا یک صلوات برای سلامتی خواهر عزیزی ما که قرآن تلاوت کرد، بلند صلوات بلند ختم کنیم.
اللهم صل علی محمد و آل محمد.
ما به چند نکته اشاره میکنیم خدمت شما عزیزان و از شما کمک میخواییم که در این قسمت ها با برد مسجد و هم دوستان عزیزان کمک کنیم. اول راجع به اسپانسر این شب ما نظر تهیه دیگه مدتر بعد از سخنرانی خدمت شما تقدیم میشه و نوشیان میکنیم. شب شام پنجشنبه که فرداش جمعه است هم نظر مد نظر گرفتیم. یه هفته مکمل ما پروگرام داریم، امشب هم داریم، فردا شب هم تا شب شنبه هم داریم. البته شب شنبه آخری شب است که پروگرام ما ختم میشه. از شما خواهش میکنیم که اسپانسر شدیم برای غذایی که مد نظر میگیریم باید در پروگرام در این سایسته بگیرم. و همچنان نیمه شعبان ما برادر عزیز ما دکتر سجادی را که سال گذشته در اینجا تشریف در محرم تشریف داشتن اونا را دعوت کردیم، اونا تشریف میارن و سخنران مجلس ما شما خواهد بود انشالله. از شما خواهش میکنیم که برای شعبان اگر یک خیرخواهی حصه بگیرم و اسپانسر شدم، لطفاً با برادر عزیز ما جناب مهندس میرافتاب در تماس شدم یا با خواهر عزیز ما نور محمدی در تماس شدم و بگم که اسپانسر میشه. همچنان فردا البته وقت زور یا بعد زور وقت بشه برادر عزیز ما آقای علی نجار تعیین میکنه برای جوانان سخنرانی دارن اینجا سبا فردا. یادتان نره که جوانای عزیز توجه کنن در این قسمت. در رمضان هم شما خبر داریم که ما سی شب و سی روز اینجا سرخان الهی آوار میشه و رضا تهیه میشه. امیدوار هستیم که شما در این قسمت اثر بگیرین و شما میفهمین که میمون کردن در رمضان کسی را اگر میمون میکنین فضیلتش چقدر زیاد است در پروی ازی که روزه میگیریم. یعنی با یک دانه خرما، یک گلاس آب، یک گلاس شربت یا هر چیز دیگه که ایره در رمضان برای یک برادر مسلمان و مؤمنتان میدین حجش بسیار زیاد است. فراموش نکنین شبای ماه مبارک رمضان اسپانسر شدین و اسمتان با اون لیستی که امشب در دیوان نصب میشه بنویسیم، هر کدام حصه بگیریم. این مسجد مسجد یک نفر دو نفر نیست، این مسجد به همت خود شما چراغش تاوار روشن مانده. امیدوار هستم که خدا شما را توانایی و قدرت بده که این چراغ همیشه روشن نگاه داریم. صلوات بلند ختم کنیم.
اللهم صل علی محمد و آل محمد.
ما امشب در برنامه خود دو سخنران عزیز داریم.
آجی سر ببخشید دیگه ماه مبارک رمضان ساعت 7 باز مسجد، یک جز قرآن هم آقای سلمان آقای شامی هست ساعت جلسی قرآن هم هست.
آه او رمضان باز رمضان رو در میکنیم بچشم. البته پیش از اینکه وقت افطار برسه مطابق برنامه های قبلی سالهای گذشته بازم مقابله قرآن داریم اینجا ساعت 7 قرآن ها باز میشه. یکی از برادرهایی که البته خوب در قرآن بلد است از نگاه تجوید اونا در راست قرار میگیرن و همه گی مطالب یا آقای شانگیان یا برادر عزیز ما هستن دوستا و عزیزا که همه حصه میگیرن. برنامه امشب ما با سخنرانی برادر عزیز و گرامی ما که بسیار جای خوشی است که باره دیگر ما میبینیم در مسجد خود در اینجا تشریف آوردن و ارجان از شان تشکر میکنیم و برای سلامتیشان صلوات ختم کنیم.
اللهم صل علی محمد.
برادر عزیز ما علی نجار لطف کردن تشریف آوردن دوباره در اینجا و ما خیر مقدم میگیم بهشان. انشاءالله امشب از سخنانشان مستفید میشیم و همچنان بعد از او، البته به زبان انگلیسی است، بعد از ایشان برادر عزیز ما آقای شانگیان با زبان فارسی، البته وقتش خیلی محدود است، در هر کدام با وقت یک معینه که شما البته خسته نشین، انشاءالله به زودی سخنرانی را آغاز میکنن و شما مستفید میشین. برای سلامتی ایشان و سلامات بلند ختم کنین و از برادر عزیز ما علی نجار خواهش میکنیم که پشت میکروفون تشریف بیارن. صلوات بلند.
اللهم صل علی محمد.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، حبيب الله العالمين، سيدنا وسندنا وشفيع ذنوبنا ومولانا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، سيما بقية الله في الأراضين الحجة ابن الحسن، روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، first and foremost, it's my pleasure and honor to be back here in this blessed community after so much memories and experiences with this community, coming in Ramadan first as a little grasshopper, and then coming back in Muharram, and coming back here in the holy month of Sha'ban to commemorate or celebrate the birth of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the birth of Imam Zain al-Abidin, and the birth of the flag bearer of Islam, Mufaw al-Abbas. It's my honor to be back here in this blessed community. I would like to thank Dr. Payman, Brother Kalbun, Brother Shahambian, and all of the brothers and sisters in general, especially the youth, who have organized and collected their efforts to make this program possible. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you all and to accept your efforts before Allah salawatu wa ta'ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Indisputably, one of the most essential questions to be asked, a question that makes clear man's purpose, goals, and true subconscious motives, a question that no pen can write and no paper can handle. For indeed, it isn't a set of words that have come to put themselves together, rather a sense of realization. A question that consists of three words, yet has encapsulated the world within it. A question which poses itself in the minds of the inquisitive and often with force. The question is, who am I? The path to self-realization is of the most tranquil and serene beginning journeys that any human being can embark onto. Because indeed, when I tend to understand myself and know where I came from and know where I am and essentially where I'm going, I tend to live with purpose. I tend to live with taste, with sweetness, with excitement, with a vision. Because many a times it's unfortunate to say that human beings live without understanding why they live. You come to ask them, excuse me brother, why are you living? It's like, well, I'm living for the sake of living. I eat for the sake of eating. I work for the sake of working. And this is of the most unfortunate things that we find in our communities. Especially when it comes to our beloved youth. You come and ask him, what's the purpose of our existence? Why have we been created essentially? See, these questions are so necessary to ask. Because the minute I ask them, I tend to see a clear vision in front of me. Is that when we commemorate the birth of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, The man who, because of him, Islam is a religion today, most prominent, most prevalent. A man that, for if it wasn't for him, you and I, 1400 years later, wouldn't be here commemorating the religion of Islam. Imam Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. For his love, give me Allah salatu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, when I just think about this man, on the 10th of Muharram, with an army that comprised of how many? 72 companions, standing in front of an army that comprised or consisted of a hadith, come and put it, 30,000, 40,000. If a man didn't understand who he was as a human being, then he wouldn't have sacrificed his own interest for the interest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because many a times we tend to sacrifice the interest of Allah for our own interest. We tend to pray, not to satisfy Allah, but so that I can tell him, oh Allah, I want the new 2011 Cadillac that just came out, right? Or I tell him, oh Allah, I want you to give me an A on my ACTs. Oh Allah, I want you to allow me to pass the exam that I'm going to take. Even our salah doesn't become for the satisfaction of Allah. Our salah becomes a satisfaction for our own self. And this is when one of the most dangerous things happen. When our salah becomes a barrier between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Besides my salah becoming a connection to Allah, where Allah says, وَاسْتَقِيمُوا وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek assistance through salah and through patience. Right? The salah is supposed to be something that connects me to Allah. But when I pray to Allah with the intention of satisfying my own self and not satisfying Allah, this is where it becomes truly a problematic issue. I pray not to satisfy Allah, but to satisfy my own self. If there was one thing that differentiated Ahlul Bayt salatu wa salamu alayhim between us and Ahlul Bayt, or between any great character individual that we have throughout the annals of history from Ahlul Bayt, is that Ahlul Bayt didn't work for their own interest. It is crucial to understand. Ahlul Bayt didn't work to satisfy their own self. They worked and strived for a greater purpose. That Abu Fadl al-Abbas in a few days will be commemorating or celebrating his birth on the 10th of Muharram. When his hand was decapitated, he didn't stop. Abu Fadl al-Abbas, your hand was just decapitated. Stop. Go and heal it. Go and cure it. Go back to the army and let Zainab alayhi salam tend to your wounds. No. My hand was cut off. He says, Wallah, in qata'tumu yamini. He says, Wallahi, if you were to come and decapitate my right arm, my left arm is there waiting anxiously for you. He says, if you cut my left arm off, I'm still there whispering to myself, Ya Allah, this is for you. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, they come to him in the last moments of his existence. They hear him whispering. They hear him whispering, Imam, you're in the last moments of your existence. What could he possibly be saying? Could he be mourning about his money that's going to go to waste? Could he be crying or weeping about his family members that are going to die? Could he be crying maybe about Zain al-Abidin, his son, or maybe his 6-month-old baby? No. They come closer to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. They listen to the son of Fatima whispering these words. He says, Ilahi, taraktu al-khalqa turran fi hawaka. وَأَيْتَمْتُ الْعِيَالَ لِكَيْ أَرَاكَ. He says, oh Allah, I have left everything to come and see you. وَأَيْتَمْتُ الْعِيَالَ لِكَيْ أَرَاكَ. And I have orphaned my own children to come and see you. Why? Why was he able to think of Allah? Today we're in the most relaxed situations. Right? We're at the climax of our relaxation time and we're not thinking about Allah. In salah time, we're not thinking about Allah. Why? Because we still haven't understood who we are as human beings. We haven't been able to align our interest with the interest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Muhammad.
That's Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi salam, at the Battle of Khandaq. Allow me to give these preliminary stages, inshallah, so we can reach the main points of our discussion, inshallah. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salam, back to how we can align our interest with Allah. That when I see something haram in front of me, when I see somebody, for example, from the opposite gender, walking in front of me, 50 billion desires begin to engender inside of me, telling me, look at him, look at her, look how beautiful that is. Shaitan comes and tells me, stare, look at it. Here is where the battle begins to take place. My nafs becomes a battlefield, becomes a platform and a battle between my intellect and between my nafs. They begin to clash, they begin to fight each other head to head. Nafs versus intellect. My aql is telling me, don't look. You're only allowed one look, right? And what one look do we have? Half an hour sometimes. My aql tells me, don't look. My nafs tells me, no, look, stare. Nobody's there. Allah is Arhamar Rahim. This is maybe arguably the most convincing arguments that our mind begins to make up. Allah is Arhamar Rahim. Every surah in the Quran, we begin with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Right? Allah is most merciful, don't worry about it. Here the battlefield begins to take place. Between my nafs and between my aql. Right? MashaAllah, you find some brothers, the radar is always on. Always on, never turns off. Right? My nafs tells me, look, stare, there it is. My aql tells me, no, put your head down. If I was to align my interest with the interest of Allah, I would lower my gaze. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. If I was to listen to my nafs and obey it, see the problem isn't that it's only a one-time thing. Okay, look at it and that's it, you're done. No, 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 no. When I listen once to my nafs, I'm strengthening it. The next time, I'm giving it more power. The next time, I'm giving it the power of command. I'm giving it the power of subjugation. That my nafs tells me to do something, instantly I begin to listen to it. This is why Ahlul Bayt say, نَفْسُكَ مَيْدَانُكَ الْأَوَّلِ. Your nafs is your number one battlefield. إِنْ قَدَرْتَ عَلَيْهَا كُنْتَ عَلَىٰ غَيْرِهَا أَقْدَرْ. If you are able to defeat it, then you're able to defeat anything else. If on the contrary, if your nafs defeats you, don't expect to be successful in anything that you do in life. So here the battle begins to take place between satisfying my own self and satisfying Allah. Thank you so much. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib at the Battle of Khandaq, what do we find? Now let's be practical a little bit. Because many times we tend to speak theoretical and philosophical and we don't know exactly what we're trying to say. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib was the master at aligning his interest with the interest of Allah. Take the Battle of Khandaq for example. He defeats Amr bin Wud. Very famous story. All of you know it. He's fighting Amr bin Wud. He defeats him and he's sitting on his chest to finish him off. He finishes him off and he goes back to the camp. They tell him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, we see something interesting. He tells him, what is it? He says, while you were sitting on the chest of Amr bin Wud al-Amri, you stood up, you took a few circles, you walked around for a few minutes, and then you went and finished him off. Why? What's the situation? Where's the wisdom in that? Tell us, Ya Ali ibn Abi Talib. Everything you do is with wisdom. Why did you do that? He says, when I was sitting on the chest of Amr bin Wud, he spat in my face. He says, I stood up. I walked for a few minutes. He aligned his interest with the interest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he went and finished him off. He says, if I was to kill him at that one moment, I would have killed him for the sake of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, no, I don't want to do anything for the sake of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, I stood up. I walked around for a few minutes. I aligned my interest with the interest of Allah, and then I finished him off for the sake of no one except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat ala Muhammad wa alihi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alihi.
To the extent where Fatima Zahra's anger becomes the anger of Allah. To the extent where the satisfaction of Fatima becomes the satisfaction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? How can we do this? It's not something easy. I need to shatter the veils, rip the veils and shatter the barriers between me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How? By knowing who I am as a human being. One of the biggest problems that we have today in our societies is that our youth suffer from identity crisis. They don't know who they are. Imam Hussein alayhi salam is standing on the battle of Karbala. The whole world is against him, literally. And he doesn't compromise his beliefs. How? Because he understood who he was as a human being. Many people come and ask, why do I need to know who I am? I'm living a relaxed life. Everything is going good. I have the best car. I'm going to the best school. My friends love me. My environment supports me. Everything is A-okay. Why should I know myself? For 5 reasons. Number 1, for me to realize the signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created within me, because Allah has created signs within us. Allah has secrets to connect to Him. And the greatest sign, Allah says, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. He says, we shall show them the signs in the universe and within themselves. Because Allah has many signs. In the universe, He has signs, the stars, the sun, the clouds, the galaxies, the cosmos. These are all signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. Yet another world, another universe, which many of us become heedless of, is the universe within our own self. Our self is a universe. And here a scientist can really get his thesis when it comes to these kinds of studies. The connection between the outer universe and the inner universe. Just like there's an outer universe, just like you have a sun, you have the black hole, you have stars, you have a system, a universal system upstairs, you have a universal system when it comes to our own self as well. We have cosmos inside of us. We have a universe inside of us. We have a whole system, gadgets and gizmos all inside of us. Allah says, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. We shall show them the signs in the universe and the signs within their own selves. And that's why Ali ibn Abi Talib, salatullahi wa salamu alayhi, he says, أَتَحْسَبُ أَنَّكَ جُرْمٌ صَغِيرٌ وَفِيكَنْ طَوَى الْعَالَمُ الْأَكْبَرُ. He says, do you think you're this little speck on the universe while within you the universe has been encapsulated? Meaning what? Meaning I'm a whole universe within myself. How can I understand those signs? By knowing myself, number one. Number two, whether I become a tool in the hand of Allah or a tool in the hand of Shaytan depends fully on knowing myself. Many of you have heard of the famous poet by the name of Jalaluddin Rumi, who today is one of the most successful poets you have in America. Jalaluddin Rumi has this rather interesting line of poetry. What does he say? He says, the whole of my life can be summarized in three phrases. He says, the whole of my life can be summarized in three phrases. He says, I was ripe, I was unripe, I ripened, then I was consumed. Listen to these lines. He says, I was unripe. First, I was in the beginning stages of my life. I had many shortcomings. I had many mishaps. I had many sins, many problems, many shortcomings that I had to overcome. Number one, I was unripe. Then I ripened. I softened my edges. I was able to conquer my ego. I was able to eradicate jealousy. I was able to get rid of envy, self-conceit, hatred, hypocrisy. I ripened. And then I was consumed. Meaning what? Meaning I was a product worthy of being bought by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إن الله اشترى من المؤمنين أنفسهم. Allah has bought. اشترى means bought. In Arabic language, اشترى means bought. Allah bought from the mu'mineen their own self. Meaning what? Meaning once you become a product worthy of being bought, Allah buys you. Meaning what? Meaning you become a drop of water dissolved in the ocean of Allah. You become something worthy. See, today if you go to, for example, Apple, you go to a store or a Mac, right? And then you see an iPhone, you see it broken, right? You see maybe the edges are a little bit cracked. You see, maybe it needs a little bit more programming. You say, I'm not going to buy this. Why am I going to get this? It's not worthy of being bought. This is maybe you're going to find something in the garage sale. And then you go to the real store, right? You see, it's beautiful, shining, right? It's glistening. It's worthy of being bought. This is something I want to buy. Allah says, remove the cracks from your own self. Allah says, soften your edges. Reprogram yourself, and you will be something worthy of being bought. Ahlul Bayt were worthy of being bought by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That every instance in their life that they found an opportunity to serve Allah, they did it. Even if it went against their own desire. Take Ali ibn Abi Talib for example. Ali ibn Abi Talib, before the Hijrah took place by Rasulullah, Jibreel came and informed Rasulullah that the enemies of Allah are coming to attack you. The likes of Abu Sufyan, Abu Jahl, and what have you, are coming to attack you. They're scheming a plan to come and kill you, Ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah goes to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He tells him, Ya Ali ibn Abi Talib, the enemies of Allah want to kill me. The enemies of Allah want to assassinate me. Right? He tells him, are you willing to sleep in my own bed so that when the enemies of Allah come, you confront them and I don't? What did Amir al-Mu'mineen say? If we want to examine the life of Ali ibn Abi Talib, we don't need to go into history. We don't need to study the battles that took place. This one incident, expand it, examine it, and you'll understand who Ali ibn Abi Talib is. What is he? He doesn't even know. He says, Ya Rasulullah, will this lead to your own safety? He tells him yes. He prostrates instantly into prostration. He goes down to prostration. He says, Shukran lillah, Shukran lillah, Shukran lillah, three times. He said, Ya Allah, I thank you for such an opportunity to protect Rasulullah. And he goes into the bed. They come and attack him. They come to move the blanket, expecting to see the Apostle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They see Amir al-Mu'mineen rising from the bed. He comes out and he says, whoever wants me to mix his flesh and bones, let him come closer. Whoever wants me, you know, to mix your flesh and bones, come closer. Nobody comes closer. They say, where's Rasulullah? They say, don't worry about it. Ali ibn Abi Talib is in front of you. Worry about Ali ibn Abi Talib and then maybe you can deal with Rasulullah. Why was he able to do that? Because he sold himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He understood that he was part of a system and the system wasn't a part of him. Meaning what? Many times today we walk, right? And we think everything, right, is inferior to us. The galaxies are inferior. The cosmos are inferior. Everything is smaller. Everything is a slave of me. Many times this happens to all of us. Our ego tends to get the best of us. Whoever we see, we don't see him as another brother to us. No, no, no. He may be from another culture. He may be from another ethnicity. But I still don't see him as a brother to me. I see him for some reason as he's inferior to me. This is a problem. Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرًا وَأُنْثَىٰ وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عَنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. He says, O mankind, listen to these verses, brothers and sisters, and let's try to take these verses and implement them in our communities. Because it's unfortunate to say that you go to many communities today and you find cultural barriers, social barriers. He's from this culture, I'm from this culture, right? I can never assimilate with him. I can never connect with him. While we're bickering about the differences between one another, the enemy is scheming and planning how to bring us down. And this is exactly what Imam Ruhullah says. He says, while the Muslims are bickering whether they should pray folded or unfolded, the enemy is planning how to cut them off. Correct or not? Yes. Pray like this, pray like that. While we're made busy, you know, it's one thing if the enemy comes and tries to distract us, but it's a whole other story if we're distracting our own self, you know? If the enemy's sitting there happy, mashallah, he doesn't need to do anything. Just when he sees the opportunity, he attacks. We're disintegrating our own communities. We're tending to bring our own communities down. Why? He's from this culture, I'm from this culture, that doesn't matter. I can never connect with him. This happens, why? Because we still haven't known who we are. We still aren't a community worth of being bought by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We still aren't individuals who are worth being bought by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The minute we can compromise, the minute we can tend to let our ego calm down a little bit, then let's expect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring the barakah in our communities. Number two. Number three, when I know myself, I have a united vision. I have one vision. I have one goal, one aim. See, the difference between Islam and other religions, what's the difference? Is that in Islam we believe there's one God. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ Ahad. See, when we discuss Tawheed, it's not only a philosophical discussion that we can have when it comes to Tawheed. Tawheed has personal implications, it has social implications, and it has spiritual implications. Tawheed. When I believe in one Lord, my mission becomes one. When I believe in one God, my purpose becomes one. Yeah, on the contrary, if I believe in three gods, right? My goal becomes in a way dispersed. My vision becomes scattered all over the place. Not only that, but when I believe in one infinite, omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent Lord, I begin to have those qualities as well. And this is very crucial to understand. I begin to have those qualities as well. Hassan, thank you so much. When I believe in one God, who is all-powerful, I become all-powerful as well. This is a secret. I tell you, if boxers or fighters or athletes knew this secret, they'd be the best. The connection between Allah and myself. The physical benefits of believing in one Lord. The spiritual benefits of believing in one Lord. Is that when I believe in one Lord who is everywhere, I become everywhere as well. He says, عَبْدِي أَطِعْنِي تَكُنْ مَثَلِي. My servant, worship me or obey me, you will be like me. تَقُلْ لِشَيْءٍ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. You say to the thing, be, and it will be. See, many times when we think of one Lord, we didn't think that I'm believing in one Lord, I'm praying to Him, everything is fine. No. When I strengthen my connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm strengthening my own self. Because what are we as human beings? We are divine prototypes. We are creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet what's the essence of each human being? The ruh, right? The soul. If I want to enhance this soul, I need to clarify my understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because my soul is but a category of the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنَ الْرُوحِ. They come to Rasulullah, they ask him, Ya Rasulullah, what is this ruh? What is this soul? قُلُ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Tell them that the soul is but a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, see the beauty of the Quran is that you can take one verse and you can do tafsir on it through another verse. The Quran is self-explanatory. For example, we have the word an'amta. The word an'amta is mentioned numerous times in the whole Quran. For example, in Surah Al-Fatiha, we say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Sirat al-ladhina an'amta alayhim. We say, guide us to the path of those that you have blessed. Keyword is blessed. So we go in the whole Quran, and we try to search for a word which means blessed, an'amta. We go to a verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum, wa atmantu alaykum ni'mati. Here we find a connection between an'amta and between ni'mati. Allah in Surah Al-Fatiha says what? Guide us to the path of those you have blessed. Who are those we have blessed, Ya Allah? Were they the companions maybe? Were they the supporters? Were they the friends? Were they the family members of Rasulullah? Allah explains it in the following verse. He says, أَلْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَلْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. Meaning what? The path of those Allah has blessed and not doomed are those who have been given wilayah in Ghadir Khum, where he says, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati. Here we find a correlation. So you find that the Quran is self-explanatory. If I want to understand one verse, I go and take that verse and search for it in following verses in the whole of Quran. The word ruh, we come back to understanding who we are as human beings. He says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنَ الْرُوحِ قُلُ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Tell them that the soul, they ask you about the soul. Tell them that the soul is from the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We go and try to find what is the command of Allah in the whole Quran. What does he say? He says, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا يَقُولُ كُنْ فَيَكُنْ. Indeed, if there was anything that Allah wanted, He said to it. He says in the beginning, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ. His command is that if he wants to do something, he says to it, be, and it will be. Meaning what? The ruh is a command of Allah. The command of Allah is the will of Allah. Therefore, the ruh is of the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the correlation that we just built. The ruh is something that Allah has given us, and something that only Allah can give us. Therefore, the ruh has characteristics which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has as well. Allah never dies, the soul never dies. Allah is all living, the soul is all living. Right? Allah is all good, the ruh is all good. The ruh is always good. We tend to contaminate it and corrupt it through our own shortcomings. Right? So if I was to examine a human being, I find he is a ruh. He is a soul. So if I want to understand who I am as a human being, I have to understand this ruh, this soul, which is the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Give me a salat, salat ala Muhammad wa ala.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Which is number three. Number four, and most importantly, when I know myself, I know Allah. This is the most important one. من عرف نفسه فقد عرف ربه. He who knows himself knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does it mean to know Allah? What does it mean to know Allah? If I know Allah and if I claim to know Allah and I'm still depressed, we have a serious problem. If I tend to know Allah and I still have problems in my life, then we have a serious issue. If I claim to know Allah and I'm still facing difficulties and I'm still attached to this dunya that when my car breaks I feel sad, then we really need to find out if we really know Allah or not. Is that Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, notice everything we speak about, this is the beauty of Islam. Anything you speak about goes back to Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Because indeed they were the representatives of Allah on this earth. Anything we speak about goes back to Ahlul Bayt. And this is necessary to understand why. Because when we take Ahlul Bayt, or other than Ahlul Bayt, as examples, we begin to act like them. See, the sense of Ahlul Bayt is very important to understand. And it's not for no reason that Allah wants us to love Ahlul Bayt in the Holy Quran. He says that when I take others as examples, that's not the only issue. I begin to act like them. I begin to speak like them. I begin to dress like them. Examine any youth today that, for example, loves... Who's a known singer out there today? Who? Bieber? Let's leave Bieber on the side for a while. Too much Bieber today. Who else? Who else is out there? For example, Gaga? Lady Gaga, Allahu Akbar. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا Lady Gaga, huh? Lady Gaga, right? The problem is that when we take Lady Gaga, what a name, Gaga. When we take Lady Gaga as an example, it's not just that I'm listening to her lyrics. No. It's not just that I'm listening to her music and that's it. I had a good time, you know, shaked my head for a few minutes and that's it. No. When I listen to Lady Gaga, when I listen to these kinds of celebrities, when I listen to these kinds of singers, that's not the end of the story. I begin to act like them. I begin to dress like them. I begin to speak like them. My swagger begins to become like them. Right? I begin to take them as role models. Yet when I take Ahlul Bayt as my example, what happens? I begin to act like them as well. And not only in my attitude, no. My marriage begins to become more successful. My social relationships begins to become more successful. My relationship with my parents becomes more successful. Why? Because Ahlul Bayt were this all-comprehensive, all-inclusive, complete role models. Right? Is that when I know myself, I know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number four. And number five, and most importantly, that comes second important, after knowing Allah is knowing yourself, is what? Is that when I know myself, I don't compromise my beliefs no matter where I am. And this is necessary for all of our youth to understand, beginning with myself. when I know who I am as a human being, I don't compromise my beliefs wherever I go. Today, and I've used this example before, many of the youth in our societies and in our communities have kind of become like a chameleon. I've used this example before. The surface, what color is it? Yellow, brown. When I place a chameleon on the surface, what color does it turn? Brown, correct? Give me a mouth, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala. Let's see some life, let's see some charisma, some energy. When I put a chameleon on this minbar, what color does it become?
Brown.
Brown. I said, when I put it on a white wall, what color does it turn?
White.
When I put it on a green surface, what color does it turn?
Green.
Why? Because it has no identity, not to be harsh on our beloved community. Youth have become exactly, not in all cases, I don't want to generalize, have become exactly like these chameleons. You place him in any environment, he begins to adapt to that environment. You put him with a, for example, a bad group, he all of a sudden becomes bad. You place him with ulama, mashallah, all of a sudden he has become an alim. You place him with rappers, he has become a rapper. And the fact that when you put him with good people, he becomes good, implies that he's not a bad person. It's just that he hasn't understood who he is as a human being. When I tend to know myself, I have this firm identity. Place me in any environment you want to, I don't adapt to that environment. It adapts to me. And I conclude with this. You have two kinds of people. One person who is enshaped by the environment surrounding him. The first person. Enshaped by the environment surrounding him. The second person, no. The first one, just like our youth, he adapts to any environment you place him in. The second, no. The environment adapts to him. Imam Hussein on the 10th of Muharram, nobody was able to affect his confidence. Nobody was able to bring him down. Nobody was able to diminish from his self-belief, his self-esteem. Why? Because his beliefs were one. Allah in his eyes was one. He only had one goal. He only had one mission. When I, as a youth living today in the 21st century, believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have a pure connection with Him, I don't compromise my beliefs. I may argue, I may have dialogue, Allah invites us to have dialogue, but I never compromise my beliefs. Why? Because I've understood Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in essence and in result, I've understood who I am as a human being. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to become ones who understand who we are as human beings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to see things as they truly are and not be distracted by the glitter and glamour of this world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to act for no reason except for His interest and not for the interest of our own self. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with the ziyarah of Imam Abi Abdullah al-Husayn in this world and with his intercession in the hereafter. Allahumma tahhir qalbi min al-nifaq وعملي من الرياء ولساني من الكذب وعيني من الخيانة فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
أحسن الله أحسن الله.
یک جان تشکر میکنیم و سپاس میکنیم از برادر عزیز ما علی نجار برای سلامتیشان سلامات خبر کنیم.
اللهم صل علی محمد و آل محمد.
برای چند لحظه خدمتتان برادر بزرگوار ما جناب آشان بیان به زبان فارسی صحبت میکنن. بعد از اون نظری هم مد نظر گرفته شده خدمت شما تقدیم میشه. صلوات بلند ختم کنین و آقای شانگیان تشریف برن.
اللهم صل على محمد و آل
محمد. سلام علیکم و رحمت الله. اعوذ بالله من الشیطان الرجیم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحیم. الحمد لله رب العالمین. الخلائق أجمعين. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى آل محمد الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين. خدا رو شکر میکنم که یک بار دیگه توفیق این حاصل شد که چند دقیقه در خدمت شما عزیزان باشم در این محفل نورانی. بسیار استفاده کردیم از سخنان برادر عزیزمون جناب آقای علی نجار و امیدوارم که خداوند به ما توفیق بده که بتونیم معرفت خودمون رو در زمینه مسائل اسلامی هرچه بیشتر و بهتر کنیم، چون اوقات به اواخر شب میرسیم و قدید دیر شده جلسه. من مبحثی رو که برای شما داشتم به طور کامل با پاورپوینت براتون تقدیم بکنم این رو واگذار میکنم به زمان دیگری و چند دقیقه خیلی مختصر فقط برای عرضه ادب به آستان ابوالفضل حسین چند دقیقه در اینجا در حضورتون هستم. میلاد پر سعادت امام حسین علیه السلام از برکات بسیار مهمی است که در ماه شعبان خداوند قرار داده. ماه شعبان همونطور که قبلا در سخنان قبلی خدمتون عرض کرده این سه ماه رجب، شعبان و رمضان دارای ویژگی های خاصی هستند و ارزش فوق العاده ای از نظر زمانی دارند و کاربرد و منافع بسیار خاصی در این ماه ها و در این سه ماه منظور شده که البته اونهایی که هوشیار هستند و عاقل از این فرصت ها استفاده می کنند. ماه رجب ماه استغفار و به تعبیر ماه تخلیه و پاک کردن جان از گناهان و معاصی و صفات ناپسند معرفی شده و ماه شعبان ماه تخلیه یا ماه آراستن جان به نیکویی ها و زیبایی هاست. یعنی وقتی یک خونه رو میخواهید شما تزیین کنید، ابتدا آلودگی ها و کثافات و گرد و خاک و کثیفی رو ازش میزدایید و بعد اون رو با عطر و گل و سایر وسایل آرایش تزیین میکنید. ماه رجب ماهی بود که در آن امیدوار هستم همه شما این توفیق رو یافته باشید که استغفار و دوری از گناهان و پاک کردن جان از صفات رذیله اخلاقی رو مد نظر داشته باشید و ماه شعبان در ادامه اون حرکت پاکسازی و خودسازی آراستن جان هست به صفات نیک. بزرگترین مظهر صفات نیک در جهان آفرینش اونگونه که ما از معارف الهی میفهمیم وجود پیامبر اکرم خاتم الانبیا محمد مصطفی است. در واقع پیامبر اکرم اساره همه فضائل انسانی و بهترین نمونه تمام کمالاتی هستند که بشریت برای نیل به اونها آفریده شده و البته خاندان نسبت و طهارت همه از یک نور واحد هستند. بنابراین اگر قرار هست که در این ماه شعبان که الان در آستانه آغاز اون هستیم بخواهیم روح خود را و جان خود را به زیباترین صفات و برجسته‌ترین کمالات مزین و تزیین کنیم، باید دنبال این در صفات و کمالات و حالات ائمه معصومه پیامبر اکرم باشه. بنابراین ماه تحلیه یا ماه آراستن جان در واقع ماهی است که ما در آن خود را به عطر اخلاقیات محمد صلی الله علیه و آله و سلم تزیین می‌کنیم. یادتون باشه که پیامبر اکرم فرمودن ماه رجب در روایات ما هست، ماه رجب متعلق است به امر ولایت و امیر مؤمنان علیه السلام، ماه شعبان متعلق است به پیامبر اکرم و ماه رمضان ماه خداست.
این مراحل همینطور در ادامه همدیگه قرار داره و امید هست که ما از این فرصت‌ها استفاده کنیم. از مباحث مهمی که در این ماه شعبان هست مسئله مناجات ها و دعاها هستش و از برجسته‌ترین این دعاها مناجات شعبانیه هست. توصیه زیادی شده است به این که این مناجات رو در این شبها فراموش نکنید و خودتون رو مقید بکنید که بعضی فصلهای اون رو یا بعضی از اون رو یا تمام اون رو در هر شب تلاوت بکنید. از معدود مجموعه های دعایی و مناجاتی هست که نقل شده که تقریبا همه ائمه نقل شده که این رو مقید بودن که تلاوت میکردن. مضامین بسیار بسیار متعالی زیبایی در اونها هست که من بنا داشتم بخشی از اون رو در یه بحث مبسوط اینجا خدمت شما تقدیم بکنم که انشاءالله در یه فرصت دیگری باید این رو تقدیمتون بکنم. مهم این استش که ما در این مناجات ها با خدای خود سخن میگیم و از زیبایی های او حرف میزنیم. وقتی از زیبایی های او حرف زدیم این کمالات رو برای خود ممثل میکنیم، برای خود مجسم میکنیم و سعی میکنیم که اینها رو در جان خود هم پیاده کنیم. به هر اندازه که این کمالات رو در خود پیدا کردیم و پیاده کردیم به همون اندازه به خدا نزدیک میشیم. وقتی انسان عاشق یک محبوبی هست، یک معشوقی دارد و از صفات و کمالات و زیبایی‌ها و الطاف او سخن میگوید، به مرور خود را به آن معشوق و محبوب نزدیک و شبیه می کند. و وقتی محبوب و معشوق شما خدا باشد، خود را باید به صفات خدا متصف و ممثل بکنید. و بهترین نمونه برای پیروی، بهترین الگو برای دنبال روی که صفات خدا را در خودمون مجسم بکنیم، همونطور که عرض کردم اهل بیت عصمت و طهارت هستن. ابو عبدالله الحسین نمونه بارز یک اسوه و الگوی حسن برای کسانی هستن که آرزومند کمال و سیر کمالی به سمت خدا هستن. از خداوند میخواهیم که در این لحظه های نورانی شبهای ماه شعبان به ما توفیق اون رو عطا کند که با مناجات ها و دعاهایی که روح ما را پاک می کند و تزیین می کند و معطر می کند آشنا بگرداند. خدایا به محمد و آل محمد اسلام و اسلامیان را یاری و نصرت عنایت بفرما. کید دشمنان اسلام را به خودشان باز گرداند. خدایا زن و فرزند ما را در پناه خودت از جمیع بدیات ارضی و سماوی مسئول و محفوظ بدار. خدایا زن و فرزند ما را از جمیع انحرافات فکری و اخلاقی و عملی حفظ بفرما. خدایا لحظه مرگ را آغاز آسایش ما قرار بده تا ما را نیامرزیده ای از این دنیا مبر. خدایا در لحظه مرگ ولایت ائمه معصومین را ریسمان الهی خود بر ما قرار بده. خدایا پدر و مادر از ما راضی و خوشنود بگردان، فرج امام زمان ما نزدیک بگردان به نبی و آله صلوات.
اللهم صل علی محمد و آله. برادران